Welcome back, you're watching ED Insight. India's first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru called dams temples of modern India. Under his leadership, huge projects like the Bhakra Nangal Dam were executed. But since the 1980s, hydropower's contribution to India's energy growth has been declining. Lakshmi Subramanian tells you why India can't count on hydropower to fuel its future.
Subansiri is a river flowing through picturesque Arunachal Pradesh. The state government has proposed a 2,000 megawatt hydropower project to be completed in 2013 to harness the river's strong flows. But these gurgling waters are the center of a big controversy. Neighboring state Assam is outraged and has been up in arms against the Lower Subansiri project since its inception in 2007.
The river is going to be degraded and the livelihood of some will be wiped out from their vicinity, and ultimately the biodiversity resources for which the people have very strong view on the biodiversity aspect, and this biodiversity will be lost due to the degradation of habitat in the downstream ecology.
Despite these concerns, work on the Lower Subansiri project is in full swing, and that too with the center's support.
प्रधानमंत्री भी चाहते हैं, ऊर्जा मंत्री भी चाहते हैं कि जब ये बांध बनेंगे वो पर्यावरण को पूरी तरह से सुरक्षित रखेंगे और हम किसी भी तरह से असम की जनता को, खास तौर से जो नॉर्थ लखीमपुर, माजोली और दिमाजी जैसे जिलों में रहते हैं, उनको कोई परेशानी नहीं होने देंगे.
We had a big slow failure while working on this, our powerhouse, which has slightly delayed our projects, say by 9 to 10 months, and which we are catching up fast with our civil contractor. We have redesigned our plant, and we are hoping that 3 units we will give by March 2012, and the remaining 5 units will come by December 2012. That is one reason, major reason for Subansiri.
Lower Subansiri is not the only project that is mired in interstate conflicts. Chhattisgarh and Orissa are fighting over a hydro project on the Indravati and Bhaskal rivers. And Karnataka and Tamil Nadu are at loggerheads over the Hoganakkal project and Chivan Samudram run off the river Hydro plant in Mekedatu. The role of individual states is of great importance in hydropower because state governments have invested in 539 of a total 802 projects that are completed or underway and have a 46% share in India's hydropower capacity. But rivers know no boundaries, which means there are cross-border challenges too.
Some are with, let's say, China, Bangladesh. So if really the climate change concerns do materialize, if there are changes in the water availability, it's more likely that the countries may go back, as we read in the media, on the agreements they have got on water sharing. The upstream states may try, countries may try to divert the water, with the result the projects which you have planned for the future may have some impact.
From political reasons to cultural ones, last month the government scrapped the Lohri Nagpala project in Uttarakhand because it was set on the Bhagirathi River, a tributary of the holy river Ganga. The government claimed it was pulling back the project due to environmental concerns, but experts alleged that the project was called off because of religious opposition.
We have 150,000 megawatt of hydro potential, of which only 26,000 megawatts is already used. But that doesn't mean we can use all 150,000. For a simple reason is, some of it to exploit would involve a lot of forests being submerged, a lot of people have to be moved out.
A few months ago, two other projects in the same river, Bhairanghati and Pala Maneri, met with the same fate. Hydro projects had traditionally been mired in controversy because they are associated with environmental damage and mass-scale displacement. That's the reason many of them don't ever take off. The biggest example of that is the Narmada project, which was envisaged by Jawaharlal Nehru in the 1940s. For decades together, that project has faced severe opposition.
Hydro is a little different from other modes like, for example, conventional coal, because the gestation period is much longer. There are huge technical uncertainties. For example, young Himalayas have a huge geological aspect, which means there can be significant delays when you take a tunnel construction through the mountain.
Parvati 2 is concerned, we got stuck in our tunnel where we were operating through our TBM tunnel boring machine. In 2006 we got stuck there. All of a sudden there was an ingress of a lot of water started coming and it was grounded, which we are now refurbished. We are working on it, work has started. So this is the major reason for delay of over another 800 megawatt Parvati 2, which is now slated to come on rail by March 2030.
These uncertainties lead to cost overruns and delays and makes it difficult for hydropower companies to find adequate capital. That's the reason why many projects have not been able to achieve financial closure. For instance, Gyanar Infrastructure has yet to achieve financial closure for its 2007 66 megawatt Sikkim hydropower project. Ditto with GMR Energy's 2006 300 megawatt Alaknanda hydropower project in Uttaranchal. The twist in the tail comes in 2008 when the Sikkim government scrapped 11 of 27 proposed hydropower projects because of delays.
People don't know when the project will start and when it will get end, when it will get halted in between.
So where does all this leave India's hydropower capacities?
Under a dark cloud, India has economically exploitable potential of 150,000 megawatts, but just 19.9% of it has been harnessed so far. The delays and cancellations in projects means that India will fall 20% short of its 11th planned target of 78,700 megawatts.
But the future of wind energy seems bright. Find out why after this short break. Stay with us.
Initially, people started off by installing these wind turbines to claim accelerated depreciation benefits. But we soon realized that, well, we have about 12 gigawatt of capacity based on wind.
If you rethink about our India grid from north to south and east to west, we can bring down a lot of our cost level also, a lot of our losses also, and same time we can build the more efficiently.
The available land predominantly is forest land and which has to be converted into land which is fit for installing wind turbines.
There's quite a remarkable difference, as I understand, between states on how land is acquired, how we get permitting, and the procedures around that also vary by state. So this is a little cumbersome from our point of view.